began in the book of Obadiah. I'm often preaching the book of Obadiah, but it's a short. Amos, Obadiah, never forget. My sister was trying to learn the book of the Old Testament, and she called it Obadiah. But that's close. Amos and Obadiah, Jonah, Michael, Nathan, Packard, and all of them. The book of Obadiah was probably written about 586 B.C. And it has actually one whole purpose, a short book, and that's sort of the reason for that. And that was to prophesy about the kingdom of Edom. The Edomites had been a problem for Israel for centuries. And they had harassed Israel and caused them many problems in the past. But God, through the prophet Obadiah, tells of how they are going to be defeated and how their kingdom is going to come to an end. I guess of all the influences that came from the Edomites, probably the house of Herod was the greatest. The Herods that were still reigning in the time of Jesus were descendants of the Edomites. And so they become an important historical group as far as that's concerned. But this morning, I want us to read a particular passage in verse 17. Obadiah prophesies, as I said, that Edom is going to fall. And verse 16, he says, they shall be as though they had not been. According to history, that would wait a while. But a little while before Jesus came on the scene, the nation of Edom ceased to exist. And there were so few of them at the end that it wasn't really a nation, it was just a scattering of people. But the prophecy of Obadiah came to pass, and the nation of Edom fell. At first to Nebuchadnezzar, and later to the Maccabean rulers. But in verse 7, verse 17, he says, but upon Mount Zion shall be deliverance. God had promised the land of Canaan to the Jews. And they had settled it under the leadership of Joshua. But a lot of things had happened, and they had disobeyed God and rebelled against His will so that they had lost that land in part and sometimes in large sections. But He says, upon Mount Zion shall be deliverance, and there shall be holiness. And the house of Jacob shall possess their possessions. That's an interesting phrase, isn't it? They shall possess their possessions. You read back in the time of Joshua, where Joshua said, God fulfilled His promise to Israel in giving them the Holy Land. It was theirs for possession. God had given it to them to settle and to take charge over. But Israel had failed to enjoy the promised land. As a matter of fact, in the book of Hebrews, the Hebrew writer says that they did not enjoy rest as God had intended it. They had enjoyed rest because they had sinned against Jehovah. But now, Obadiah says, Jacob shall possess their possessions. This morning, for a few moments, we want to discuss some things that we possess, but we don't possess them. There are some things that we have, but we don't really have them. Either as a society, as a nation, as a people, and sometimes as Christians. There are things that God has given us, just as that He gave the land of Canaan to Israel. But for whatever reason, they failed to enjoy it. They failed to have the rest that God intended for them to have. The first thing I'd like for us to notice this morning is our Bibles. How many of you have one? One of the greatest things I like to see when I come to worship God is people with a Bible in their hand. Bibles are the world's greatest book, bar none. It's still the number one top seller in the whole universe. It's owned by more people than any other book. Back in March of 2013, they did a research study and concluded that about 88% of all Americans own a Bible. You see, the problem with America is not that we don't have access to the Bible. good thing. But just because you have a Bible doesn't mean you possess it. Another study that was done found that only 52% of Americans ever read the Bible once a month. 52% do not read the Bible at least once a month. Well, that's not a real surprise. And when you watch the game shows and you see people trying to answer Bible questions, isn't it sad and hilarious at the same time? I remember watching one show of Jeopardy where a preacher failed to answer one of the simplest Bible questions you could imagine. And I wanted to fall over. Ridiculous. When you talk to people on the street, probably they have a Bible. But do they know what's in it? Most of the time, no. A number of years ago, we were knocking doors in Jacksonville, Florida, and came to an apartment complex. I knocked on the door, a man came out, and I began to talk to him about the Bible, invite him to a Bible study. And the man said, "No, I'm not interested, I'm an atheist." Around that time, his little daughter, about 3 or 4 years old, came toddling up behind him. And she said, "Daddy, I have a Bible." He said, "Shut up, get back in there." I went away thinking, how sad. Here's a father. His little girl has a Bible, but she doesn't know a thing about it. And he's not going to help her find out anything about it. Because he claims to be an atheist. He didn't want anybody to know his little daughter had a Bible. She probably had to give it to her by somebody. I'm afraid our society today is a little bit like that man at the door. I don't need the Bible. I don't need to read it. I don't need to know what's in it. In 2 Timothy, the 3rd chapter, we have one of the strongest statements about God's Word that is found anywhere. And it comes from an inspired writer recognized by his credentials, the Apostle Paul. And I want us to begin reading in chapter 3 of 2 Timothy, beginning at chapter 3, verse 15. Paul's writing here to the younger man, Timothy. And he says, "But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned, and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them. And that from a child thou hast known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus." And then Paul says, "All Scripture is given by inspiration of God, and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works." Paul appreciated the fact that Timothy had a mother and grandmother who introduced him to the Holy Scriptures. Timothy had grown up knowing about the Bible. And as a result, the Apostle Paul says, "These Scriptures are able to make thee wise unto salvation." You know, of all the books in the world, and there are scads of them, aren't there? I go to bookstores and I'm just overwhelmed with all the shelves filled with books, every kind you can imagine, on topics you never believed. Some of those ridiculous things. I've seen some books I can imagine somebody paying somebody to write. But they're there. And people read those things. Books are everywhere. There is only one book. There's only one book that can make us wise unto salvation. There's only one book that is from God, inspired of God. That's not said of any other book I have ever read. And I've looked for it. No other book claims what the Bible claims. In 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 15, Paul would again encourage Timothy to study. And he says, "Study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needs not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." There are books, and then there are books. There are books, and then there is the book. I read one time of a preacher who was visiting a home, and the mother wanted to impress him a little bit, so she told her little boy, came home from Sunday school, he told his parents, he said, "I know what the word Bible means. It means basic information before leaving Earth." Bible. Basic information before leaving Earth. You know, he was right. There is not another book anywhere that tells us where we came from, what we're doing here, and where we're headed. None. And yet people have the Bible. They have access to it. Most people have a Bible laying out in their house somewhere. If nothing else, they have the family tree in it. But they have a Bible. But you know, if you don't read the Bible, if you don't study the Bible, if you don't apply the Bible, you might as well not own one. For he who won't read the Bible is no better than he who doesn't have one. Literally. But notice that Paul says the Bible is our source of salvation. If you go back to the book of Psalms, in the 119th Psalm, David wrote down what he thought of God's word. And in those verses are just marvelous statements. I want us to begin noticing in the 119th Psalm, verse 11. Notice some things that David said about the Bible. He says, "Thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. Blessed art thou, O Lord, teach me thy statutes. With my lips have I declared all the judgments of thy mouth. I have rejoiced in the way of thy testimonies as much as in all riches. I will meditate in thy precepts and have respect unto thy ways. I will delight myself in thy statutes. I will not forget thy word." The Bible has a tremendous power. It keeps us out of trouble. "Thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin." How many times have we as Christians thought about doing something or saying something or not doing something when a passage of Scripture comes to mind and we think, maybe I shouldn't be doing that. I think that happens often. And I think that's what David had in mind. People who know the Bible live a different kind of life. They are regulated by the teachings of God and by the principles that are found therein. Well, notice in verse 49 of this same 119th Psalm, David writes, "Remember the word unto thy servant upon which thou hast caused me to hope. This is my comfort in my affliction, for thy word hath quickened me." The Bible gives us strength, encourages us, gives us hope, and gives us life. We need to read the Bible. We need to try to understand it. And then in verse 97 of the 119th Psalm, David said, "Oh, how love I the law, it is my meditation all the day. Thou through thy commandments hast made me wiser than my enemies, for they are ever with me. I have more understanding than all my teachers, for thy testimonies are my meditation. I understand more than the ancients, because I keep thy precepts." You realize that David here is saying we're the smartest people on earth if we own a Bible and really know it? We know more about the universe. We know more about history. We know more about what lies ahead than anybody else. If we understand what God has told us. And therefore David said in verse 103, "How sweet are thy words unto my taste, yea, sweeter than honey to my mouth. Through thy precepts I get understanding, therefore I hate every false way." How do we navigate this life? How do we figure out what's right and what's wrong? It's not in man that walks to direct his own step, but God, through his word, will lead us through that maze. "For the word of God is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our pathway." We need that. Everybody needs that. Francis Bacon, years and years back, wrote an essay entitled "On Studies." And in it, he had this to say. He said, "Some books are to be tasted, others need to be swallowed. Some few to be chewed and digested. That is, some books are to be read only in parts, others to be read but not curiously, and a very few are to be read wholly and with diligence and attention." Can't do that with the Bible. The Bible is the Word of God. The Bible is the source of salvation. The Bible is the truth of God. There are two times in the Bible itself that God commanded his prophets to eat a book. I don't know if Francis Bacon got his idea from these or not, but in Ezekiel chapter 2 and verse 10, Ezekiel is told to eat a book. That book was a prophecy that God gave to the prophet to deliver Israel. And he said, I want you to eat it. So he gave it to him in a scroll, and Ezekiel put it in his mouth, and he chewed it, and it tasted sweet. And he said, now I know what God wants me to do. Some folks need to be eaten. The Apostle John, Isle of Patmos, in Revelation 10, verse 9, was given a similar book. An angel handed him a book, and he said, here, eat. It was a book about the prophecy of future events. John did as he was told and chewed on the scroll and ate the words of God. And it was sweet to his taste. Just as the psalmist expressed, thy words are sweeter than honey. Why? Because they give me understanding. They give me insight. They teach me the way of God. Many years ago in the state of New Jersey, an individual went to the funeral of his aunt. And when her estate was divided up, he was the recipient of her family Bible. Well, he took it home. He never cracked it, never opened it. It lay in the shelf for 30 years. One day, some of his ancestors were going through his belongings, and they took that Bible that belonged to his aunt, and they began to open it. $100 bills started to fall out. There was $15,000 in that Bible. And he never knew it. He never knew it. That's sad, isn't it? After I read that, when I am anywhere in a bookstore and I see Bibles, you know what I'm doing? I'm checking that book. I'm going to see if those $100 bills start to fall out. Isn't that sad, though? People have a Bible, but they don't use it. They don't own it. They don't get the use of it. They don't get the benefit of it. I'll tell you what, there are things in the Bible worth a lot more than $15,000. Jesus said, what is a man profit gaining the whole world and lose his own soul? Think about it. We need to open that book. We need to open that Bible. But secondly, we have Jesus. I hear people talk about this. Oh, Jesus is my Savior. Jesus is wonderful. I love Jesus. But I guarantee you, after discussing Jesus with them for a while, you'll find out they don't have any clue of Jesus. It's like Jesus is a symbol of something. Jesus is the one that's going to save me someday. Well, how's he going to do that? By ignoring him? By putting him off to the side? By never studying his teachings? By never obeying his message? It's sad, isn't it? We sing a song sometimes, take the world and give me Jesus. That demands something. You have to own Jesus. You have to come to grips with Jesus. God loved the world and gave his only begotten Son that we might be saved. Now what are we going to do with it? Oh, earth, 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 what have you done to Jesus? Well, we'll make a movie about him. We'll present him as a great teacher. We'll make him look funny. We'll change him up. We'll write a book and express some kind of goofy notion about some of his teachings. Those things are all false. Jesus is found in the Word of God. And Jesus tells us that we must follow his teaching, his word. If you have the Bibles, you might turn with me to John 6 chapter. In John 6, beginning verse. John 6 and verse 51. Jesus here had fed the multitudes, and they come back to him, and he says, "You're here in order to eat, not to listen to follow me." But in verse 48, he tells them, "I am the bread of life. This is the bread which comes down from heaven, that a man may eat thereof and not die." And then verse 51, "I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world." And then we get the question, how can this man give us his flesh? And then he explained, "Except you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you." You follow down, Jesus explains that his word is the source of life. And in John the 12th chapter in verse 48, Jesus said, "He that rejecteth me and receiveth not my word hath one that judgeth him. The words that I speak unto you, the same shall judge you in the last day." And so to eat the flesh of Jesus, to drink his blood, is to consume his teaching. Just as Jesus taught on the Sermon on the Mount. When he said, "A wise man hears these sayings of mine and does them, he builds his house on a rock, and it stands." Just exactly like our lives can stand on the rock of Jesus Christ. We must continue to follow him. We must obey him. In 1 John chapter 3, the Apostle John describes this for us, how we are blessed in being able to follow after him. Verse 22 of 1 John chapter 3, "Whatsoever we ask, we receive of him, because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in sight. And this is his commandment, that we should believe on the name of the Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another as he gave us commandments. And he that keepeth his commandments dwelleth in him, and he in him. And hereby we know that he abides in us by the Spirit which he hath given us." The Spirit here is often in the New Testament a reference to the teachings of Jesus. The Spirit which he sent to the apostles, which he said would remind you of everything I've said to you. The teachings of Jesus change our lives and make us acceptable to the Father. So much so that Jesus said, "I will dwell in them and they will dwell in me." It's one thing to know Jesus, but it's another thing for Jesus to be with us, to dwell with us, to be in our lives and to regulate our lives. The Apostle Paul in Philippians 3 said, beginning in verse 7, that he would be willing to give up everything and count it but refuse, that he might win Christ and be found in him. We not only need to know about Jesus, we need to make Jesus the master of our lives. We need to put Jesus behind the wheel. I really get infuriated when I see these cars driving around. I don't see as many as often as I used to. Jesus is my co-pilot. No, friends, Jesus better be our pilot. He's the one who's going to lead us to eternal life. He is the one whose words will judge us in the last day. He is the one who is the source of all of our hope in having our sins forgiven. And so Jesus can be possessed. I like the words of Paul in Galatians 2 and verse 20. He said, "I'm crucified with Christ." You see, Paul takes his life as it was, and he puts it on a cross, and he says, "That's me. That's where I was. I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I continue to live. But it's not me. It's Christ living in me." May God help us to possess Jesus Christ. May God help us to truly possess that Bible we hold in our hands. It's more than a book. basic instruction before leaving Earth this morning. Will you follow that man? Will you follow those words? Will you follow the Lord who died for you? We urge you to render obedience to Him, believing in Him, to be this very Son of God, the promised Messiah of the world. Turning from sin in your life and saying no to those things that are forbidden by God, whatever they are. Confessing Christ with your mouth. For He said, if you'll confess me before men, I will confess you before the Father in heaven. Matthew 10, 33 and 33. And then be greeted with the baptism. Or, as Ananias told Saul of Tarsus, arise, be baptized, and wash away your sins. Call on the name of the Lord. Why would I do that? Number one, it's in the Bible. Number two, Jesus taught it. That very well is all. We not obey Him this morning.